I would anyway like to know where you were born, when you were born, and about your schooling.
Okay, I was born in 1941 in a small village called Kutanur, where the only goddess Saraswati's temple is there in India. This is in the erstwhile Tanjore district. But my father was living in a village called Nachiyarkoil. This is very near to Kumbakonam. I studied all my school education in Nachiyarkoil. And then from that I went to St. Joseph's College, Trichy. I did the MSc, up to that MSc I did in St. Joseph's College, Trichy. Then the PhD in IIT.
Now, see, the St. Joseph's College, were you staying in a hostel? Or?
Yeah. That is, in those days there were two hostels, Clive's Hostel and New Hostel. Clive's Hostel is a famous, and I was living in a room called 93, because 93 is traditionally all my family members have lived there.
My
uncle is a professor in St. Joseph's College. He also studied in St. Joseph's College. So that is how we came in. My brother also studied in St. Joseph's, stayed in the same room. I also stayed in the same room.
Now, I want to share with you something, since he told about St. Joseph's College. Now, he joined IIT Madras as a research scholar in 1964. And since then, I have almost treated him as an younger brother. And I have never called him by his name. As just now Kumaran mentioned, he was known as B.V. then, B. Viswanathan, even for students and colleagues and others. And he mentioned about St. Joseph's College, and then in 65, this is an anecdote, I was on my way to Palani along with my wife and small daughter of 2 years. And then on this day before I had to leave Trichy, I was staying very near St. Joseph's College. I entered St. Joseph's College compound, and it was Christmas time. I was just walking, and there was reflection of sunlight on the second floor or so, some labs. But then I thought it was some light burning in some place. And I just showed and then commented to my wife, I think that must be the chemistry library or chemistry department. And then I didn't see that in front of me, two fathers were coming. One of them happened to be the principal, Father Casimir. Another was an American guest, another father who had come for the Christmas. And immediately, Professor Casimir said, you are pointing out there, is somebody connected with this college? Then I told him, no, but one of our very good students who works in our laboratory, Viswanathan, has studied here. And so I was just telling my wife, maybe. Then, you know, it was surprising. He said, please wait for 2 minutes. He just walked up to the father's lodge, left the guest there, asked somebody to provide him the keys for the chemistry department. He walked with me, family, opened all the labs, opened the library and said, this is a place where B. Viswanathan used to spend his time reading, till I come and tell him, go home and sleep, go to the room and sleep. He used to study for a long time and all. I can never forget two things. One, about the impression he had created at St. Joseph's College. Next, a head of an institution, just for the sake of a guest who was walking in the compound, opening the department. I mean, he felt so proud of his department, so proud of his college, somebody was talking about it. And if I remember right, Father Casimir was a classmate of Professor Kuriakos, one of my colleagues in Loyola College here in Nungambakkam. And later, I think, he became the Archbishop of Mylapore. So I don't know whether he's still there. He was a chemistry master.
Yeah, when he was an archbishop, and he used to come to IIT for walking in the morning. And he will definitely drop in my house.
You were a campus resident?
Yes, at that time. At that time, I have become a faculty member.
Yeah.
So, therefore, I was in campus resident.
You were in the warden squad, is it?
No, no. I was in a D, now old Canara Bank, D2.
Oh, I see, I see. Oh, you were in that Adyar Avenue. Yeah. You were, most of the time, you were in the hostel. So, you first, of course, as a student, stayed in the Kaveri hostel. And then, I think as a warden, you must have stayed in Saval hostel.
Yeah, yeah. Nearly 30 years I was spending in hostels.
Yeah, that's so you have been a chairman, councilor, warden.
Yes, all the posts.
Okay. Now, I just want to go back to the remembrances. So, when you joined in 1964, you were along with three other research scholars. Do you remember?
Yeah, yeah. Swaminathan and Kannan.
No. No. I think now I will try to correct you.
Hmm.
Swaminathan and Jain.
Jain is 1 year senior to me.
Oh, I see.
Kannan is my classmate. Joined in the same year. See, Jain is senior to me.
When did he join then?
He is joined in 63 December. I joined in 64 July.
Yeah. Oh, then Udupa?
Udupa also is senior to me.
I see.
By few months.
Kannan, Swaminathan.
Yes.
And I think those who did MSc, that is Santanam and then Vekappaya became...
All of them are juniors to
they
me.
They joined at some time. Now, Professor Viswanathan, when he started his research work, I think three or four of us, including Professor Shastri, head of the department, Viswanathan, myself, we had only one lab because we didn't have much space. And then I assisted him in building up the adsorption laboratory. I had not built a unit, adsorption unit, when I did my PhD. So that too on a slotted angle frame, it was a lot of difficulty. And then myself and Professor Viswanathan used our experience of working with glass blowing torch. So in fact we had to make position joints and all that. And the whole frame we made, we don't have even a photograph of that now. And we had to put wooden pieces behind, had to deal wood, that's all we could get, not even teak wood. So on that we had to mount the burettes and all the bulbs and everything, we used to do it. That was the first unit. And then when the department moved to the new building, Applied Chemistry building, that unit was also shifted. Of course, it doesn't exist anymore. We shifted and it was used for several years later also. Now, Bibi, you have done work in lots of areas. Now, first and foremost, I would like you to remember, you said about the research scholars, Kannan, Jain, and others. Do you remember that you must have joined after that gas plant explosion took place?
Yes.
You are not aware of that one, okay. But you were there when the liquid nitrogen plant came?
Yeah, yeah.
So you were very much there.
Because I was the first operator of that.
Yeah. I mean, we used it, in fact. In fact, I remember the cancer hospital, it was way back in 1964-65, they wanted to do some experiments with the cells, cancer cells, and so they didn't want to first take the liquid nitrogen there. They brought that thing and then we provided the liquid nitrogen and they did the experiments right in our lab. And then next time onwards, we told them, I will spare you a Diwar flask, and they started experiments. That is, that doctor is no more, saying that Muthulakshmi's son or somebody like
yes.
that. He was the first medical officer in the Cancer Institute, which is in the Adyar, not in the present place. Now, you said about the PhD program. So, you were registered with Shastri and
Viswanathan.
Remember, I think after the adsorption apparatus was set up, you must have done one pore size, a pore volume measurement. That means going from very low pressure to the atmospheric pressure. How many hours would you have taken to complete the experiment?
Initially, it was taking 2 or 3 days.
2 or 3 days to complete.
So continuously, because the temperature has to be maintained by pouring liquid nitrogen. There is no temperature control and all that. So therefore, we 3 or 4 days, maybe sometimes even a week.
Because
one week completely, you have to keep awake.
See, the results have to be taken once in 2 hours, 3 hours, till the once the equilibrium is obtained. Fortunately, we had a liquid nitrogen plant. There was no problem. But then, you know, you had to work day and night to taking readings. When it becomes constant, it would take. And those readings had to be sort of filled up in an equation, and finally the pore size volume distribution had, pore size distribution, pore volume calculation had to be done. And let me tell you that he developed a mathematical method for the calculation of pore size distribution, and it was published in Journal of Catalysis. Am I right?
Yes.
So experimental work is something, so he felt it is good also to do some theoretical work, and he started this one at that same time to do that calculation also. I think you must have had a very good background in mathematics.
Yeah, I had a background in mathematics. Actually, I wanted to do mathematics, but in my family, my both brothers are mathematicians. Therefore, they forced me to take chemistry.
That is
how I came to chemistry. But I had some flair for mathematics.
Oh, that is how you continued your this. Okay, now, from what I see, the thing you provided, now, I just want to ask you about various aspects of studies you have done in the last 50 years. I would say 50 years, because you already completed more than 50 years. Now, your very first thing was an adsorption. And even when you were working as a research scholar, we had one more person who joined as a research scholar, Mr. Person from Sekri, I forget his name, Rajagopala, S.R.
Rajagopala.
Yeah, he said, I'm sorry, I told you. Now, there was one Mr. S.R. Rajagopala who joined as a research scholar. If I remember right, it is a unique case, at least in the IIT Madras, that Mr. Rajagopalan was only a bachelor's degree, and that too, not only that, he was a bachelor's degree in natural science, botany, zoology or something like that. But then he was directly registered for PhD, and he secured his PhD in IIT Madras. Not only that, later he was a joint guide from students in IIT Madras for PhD, along with, I think, T.V. Ramakrishna. And he was taken from Karaikudi CSIR Laboratory all the way to the National Aeronautical Laboratory, and he retired from there.
Yes.
And his wife was also a scientist there.
Yes.
Now, can you tell me where Mr. Rajagopalan is?
He is now in Bangalore, settled down in Bangalore. His wife is Indira Rajagopalan.
I know.
They both of them live there, but they don't have any issues. So but his sister-in-law has a son, so he is living with his sister-in-law's son
in
Bangalore. I met him a few months back.
He must be nearing 90.
He is 90, not 90. He is 85 or 86.
Yeah, he's elder to me, I know. 86.
Is 90, 60, so now 27 years, so 87.
Oh, 87, oh, I see. Now he was, I had also some collaboration with him, but unfortunately we did not publish any work. I had met him several times in National Aeronautical Laboratory. In fact, we wanted to bring him as a director for the Spic Science Foundation, for the Electrochemistry Division. Parsarthi wanted to replace, but then he was not interested to come at that time. Now, please tell me your work on adsorption as such. So can you please?
Okay, adsorption, I have done various aspects of adsorption, as you know very well, but on metals, on the pore size distribution, many others, even vapors adsorption also I have done, isopropyl alcohol or some organic matter, we will not go into the details. So therefore, vapor adsorption at that time was not known in this country. The permanent gas adsorptions are known. Vapor adsorption was not known. So vapor adsorption, and why I did vapor adsorption is I converted into catalytic reactions. So therefore, catalytic reactions adsorption is important. So in that way, I went to the adsorption of the vapors. Then we built up some microbalance and all those things, and you know very well. One of the microbalances which was originally done in this place, okay, we didn't have a corn balance, commercial balance, only quartz spring balance were there. So therefore, quartz spring balance only we were using first. Then we purchased a corn balance. Then we purchased more than one corn balance. So from the from the adsorption, I deviated to at that point of time to catalysis.
I see that catalytic reactions.
Yeah, but still now, even you said about the framework and all that, we have still the frameworks, the slotted angle frame and the adsorption units still there. Okay.
I see.
It is not used now because people are not having that up here. Because you know very well, even to take one adsorption isotherm, it is only a few points, but it will take one full day. So therefore, now people are wanting everything in the computer, and the results must be within few hours or few minutes. That is so. Therefore, nobody has the patience to use those apparatus. But it is still there.
I see. Now, in this connection, I wanted to mention it was interesting observation. But you know, once we were trying to do that pore volume measurement, pore up to the saturation pressure with nitrogen on the corn balance. So I don't know how much time it took, maybe one day. And then something happened very funnily. So the quartz bulb was containing the sample. And then, just as it is, the nitrogen temperature, and I was thinking that we are going to make a measurement, and I was very much there, and suddenly there was a disturbance, and then the entire powder in the thing got tilted out. And then I said, what is this? Why is it happening? You know, I was surprised that the nitrogen was possibly contaminated a little bit of oxygen, and this oxygen had condensed in the form of a thin hair, and these had connected to the sides of the bulb, and so that disturbed because the balance was no longer free, and the entire thing got disturbed and the whole powder fell down. And I said, this is very funny. So next time I didn't go through the entire pore volume, just went to the saturation pressure, very near, and again repeated, again it happened. So I knew the nitrogen gas we had filled up was possibly impure. It was said to contain oxygen. I never reported this in any of this one, but it is an experience which I always remember. And you mentioned about the other balance. We did obtain the Stanton thermobalance, unfortunately, because when the whole thing was shifted from one building to another, and then I can't blame Professor Shastri or anybody, but then 20 years later, parts of that which were lost were found in one of the cupboards in the laboratory, and it was too late. By then, you know, corn balance, we had just condemned it somewhere. And then I felt so sorry about it. And I told this to Prasinivasan just before retired. It was lying somewhere there. I don't know whether I must have told you. Because this is not the only thing that we lost in this. Another was parts of the microcalorimeter. And I think the parts of the potassimeter, because potassimeter we could never set it up. Potassimeter we set up, but the other one we could not set up, the
calorimeter.
And you know, this was something which happened because of things when happened, the shifting and all that. And microcalorimeter was a bit damaged also. Have you made use of that first mass spectrometer which came?
I didn't use the first mass spectrometer, which was in the HSB, it was installed. I was responsible for installing it.
That's correct. Then Ramana
took over as a, because he was working on mass spectrometer of the fragments. But I have you installed it and used it.
I see. That was only meant for
organic vapors is mostly and at that time we were using permanent gases and other things.
Yes.
Therefore, we didn't use it extensively, but I have used it.
I see. Okay, now you became a lecturer in 1960, associate lecturer in 1968 or 69 you became, is it? I see. So, I think by the time the institute celebrates Diamond Jubilee, you will be celebrating your Golden Jubilee as a faculty member. So, Mr. Kumaran, so I think we must remember he is going to celebrate his Golden Jubilee as a faculty member.
Yes.
By about, say, 2 years' time now. Now, let me then ask about the catalytic reactions. You have carried out a number of catalytic reactions. And any reaction which you think we could have commercialized, and possibly for some reasons it didn't go to that stage.
Okay, many things we could have commercialized. For example, recently we did Narimanam, you might have heard about it. Narimanam is a village in Tanjore district, or very near to Karaikal. There they found oil. But the oil cannot be directly used, because the sulfur content is 720 ppm.
Oh, I see.
So it has to be refined and brought to, for example, even today in the cities, okay, in the metropolises it should be 50 ppm, and in the rural areas it can be 100 to 150 ppm. Okay, that is the refined petrol or diesel or fuel. Let us not worry about it. So, but what they were doing is, they were shipping the from Narimanam to Chennai, refined it, and then brought it back to the villages. So we developed a process by simply pumping the oil through a column. We can bring down the sulfur content from 720 to less than 150. And then it can be sold in the rural areas there itself. Because the amount of crude oil that was available at that time is not some metric ton, million metric tons. It is only few tons. Okay, so therefore, the bringing it here and refining it and bringing it back there, it will be unnecessarily adding the cost. So this process, this is one of them. Okay, there are many processes that we have developed. So this process we developed for CPCL. Today's TPCL, at that time MRL, Madras refineries. But you know very well, in this country, any development that you do, it should be also include some perks. Now, we cannot give any perks to them. So therefore, it was not implemented. But I had very good connections with the CMD of MRL from the first Deenadayalu, and then subsequently all of them are personally known to me. So that is one of the reasons why we did for them. This project started in 80s, you may be knowing, with Sidharaman as the head of R&D. And then we even in 2004-2005, we were working for the Narimanam project.
I see.
So this is one of them. The same way we have done, developed an alumina catalyst which is having pore size. At that time, alumina and silica, as you know very well, as carbon is one of the coconut shell carbon is one of the Indian famous, but it is no longer good because now the Chinese are bringing carbon 3000 square meters per gram, whereas coconut charcoal and other things will have only 200 to 300. At that time, the Indian Oil Corporation also was interested in alumina. So we developed an alumina which is porous alumina which will have surface areas greater than 300 square meters.
I see.
Because normally alumina will have only 150 to 200.
What alumina was it?
It is a gum alumina. Because it is a support for many of the refining processes.
Yeah, right.
So therefore, this was about to be commercialized by one of the companies. We will not name them. So the but somehow or other IOCL did not pursue it further. But we went and manufactured this. The same way, as you know, when we did the work for CPCL, the main catalyst in the refining is FCC, fluid catalytic cracking. Now, if you take in India itself, we are importing for FCC catalyst. Even if you put an optimist estimate, 10,000 tons per year, 10,000 tons of the catalyst are being imported. So what we did was we developed a catalyst for FCC in our laboratory, and then I went to a manufacturing company. At that time, the manufacturing company was in West Bengal.
I remember.
I went there. We have developed the catalyst. Then we the representative from the MRL, Mr. Dr. Meenakshi Sundaram, and myself were returning. When we arrived here by train, at the time they purchased that company. The Western company purchased the manufacturing unit and destroyed it within 2 days, because they know fully well that the FCC catalyst will be manufactured in India, and they did not want, because
this is news to me.
Yes, but we cannot tell this out. How can we tell this out?
Who purchased it? Who built it?
This is the company belonged to Hindustan Lever.
Oh, I see.
The manufacturing company was belonging to Hindustan Lever, and you know very well these are all multinationals.
Yeah.
They will be able to manipulate everything. Everything happened within 3 days. We had to come from Haldia to Howrah to Chennai by train. By the time we arrived here, already everything is.
This is news to me. I only know that the MRL was not interested.
No. MRL was very much.
MRL, see, the company said you had to order for 1 crore worth of catalyst.
Yeah. That is it.
And these people were hesitant to do it. And then that is why I said that you should at least file patents. And they agreed, and we joined.
We still have the patent. 3 patents are there.
That's correct.
Because why they asked is the MRL at that time, not now, at that time the capacity for FCC catalyst was 300 tons. And each ton at that time itself 1 lakh. Now we are not talking about the cost of today. So therefore per year they have to buy 300 lakh of rupees. So therefore they said, because at that time there were only about 9 or 10 refineries. Now we have 17 refineries in India. So, and also the biggest refinery in the world itself is there in India, the Reliance.
Reliance, yeah.
Okay, because they are consuming about, maybe about 1,500 tons of FCC catalyst. Anyway, about 1,000.
You mean the FCC catalyst, they still used or hydrocracking and other things?
No. This is FCC is a part of that. Okay.
Yeah, it's a part. Yeah,
once you do the FCC, then you can do hydrocracking and all those things.
Except for the
higher fractions.
Okay. So we have covered about the, I'd say, catalytic reactions to something which is a lot of industrial interest. One more project which we started, and you were very much involved in that, was the hydrogen energy. And naturally, there was a hydrogen energy, a material science laboratory, and Professor Shastri tried to put forward what India is capable of doing in hydrogen energy in the world level and all that. But then, what is the present state of this hydrogen energy thing in India and in the world as such?
Okay, your
contribution.
My contribution, I will come to it later. The present status of hydrogen energy in India is very, very meager, okay? I mean, when compared to other countries. This is because the production is from the decomposition of water, okay? The decomposition of water at the moment, in the commercial scale, not laboratory scale, in the commercial scale, if you have to take, the efficiency is less than 10%, single-digit percent. If any chemical process you are to carry out, it should be having at least Carnot efficiency, 33%. Then only it will, even if you take solar cell, the silicon solar cells is only 26%. That is why they are looking for alternatives for solar cells. So therefore, the problem here is the materials.
Ice.
The H2O getting decomposed is requires 1.23 volts, but it will not decompose if you apply 1.23 volts. You have to put some over voltage.
Yeah.
So therefore, if you put all those things, the efficiency will come down.
Yeah.
Okay. That is the problem. Even today, Western world is trying. Okay. I myself have addressed the American Chemical Society. Number of times I was specifically invited for this. Okay. In addition to that, even the hydrogen storage.
Yeah.
You may be knowing in 1999, you may be knowing the scientist also, I don't want to name him, he's a very famous scientist from Northwestern University.
Mm-hmm.
He reported a value of 67.8%.
Uh-huh.
And 2001, I was asked to address the American Chemical Society, what is the status of the hydrogen storage in solid state materials?
Uh-huh.
So the first line I said is, this result is nonsense. The whole of the audience or Americans stood up, what is all this really? Then I said, you see, in the nature, carbon and hydrogen ratio is, if you take the highest hydrogen containing carbon material is CH4. So 12 plus 4, 16. 16 grams can contain 4 grams. Therefore, if I have 100 grams, it can contain only 25.8%. 67.8% storage is impossible. So this is, there are other evidences also, we will not go into all of them. The oxidation potential, reduction potential, we can use, all those things we can show. Many ways I proved, within 5 minutes I proved, everybody sat down. I mean, it is not too, so now that is one of the, that is also, today also is a problem. Now I will tell you, because if you take metals, okay, metals is the one of the ways where hydrogen can be stored. Even in IIT, in mechanical engineering, in chemistry, in physics, all the places are metals or intermetallics are used for hydrogen storage. But in the case of the metals, if you have one metal atom, one hydrogen alone can be stored. Okay? It is not the stoichiometry. It is the vacant space that is available.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So therefore, if I have iron, 55 grams will store only 1 gram. So 100 grams of iron will store 2 grams only. So even if you take a very, unless otherwise the atomic weight of the metal is going to be 10, then you can 10 1 1 therefore 110%. So that is why magnesium is storing more. Storing more. So you should not immediately say all metals will store more. Whereas carbon will store up to 25.8%, but we can make only one residual valency.
Yeah.
The other three has to be connected to other three carbons. Only at the surface carbon alone, one have one residual valency. That will store 25 by 4, that is 6.25. That is the original DOE standards. They expected only 6% storage.
In carbon?
Carbon.
Whatever may be the type of carbon?
Any type of carbon, technically and scientifically, you can achieve 6% storage. But we are not yet achieved that.
Naturally.
That is a different situation. So therefore, even the hydrogen production and hydrogen storage is a fertile field of research even today.
I see.
And not only fertile field of research, it is as a very, very many things can be done in that.
No. You don't talk about the metals or alloys. intermetallocene. But just a porous material like a zeolite or a very, can that at least be used?
Yeah, yeah. That is MOF. You might have heard about it, metal organic framework.
Yeah,
which is having very high porosity. See, where hydrogen storage can be done to whatever extent you want, but the material must be recyclable at least 10 to 20,000 cycles.
Right.
Then only it is economical. For example, you have a petrol tank. Tank is there, therefore you can go on filling it up. In the same way, if I have a material, it is a tank. It takes the hydrogen and gives back the tank. So it should be capable of taking any number of cycles. At least for an automobile applications or for mobile applications, the cycling must be at least 1,000 times. If possible, it must be tens of thousands. Now, these materials will not stand with that. It will be one or two times only.
Then, how is it they are talking of running automobiles on hydrogen energy?
Yeah, that is what the hydrogen can be stored in cylinder various ways.
Yeah.
So, therefore, that is a weight penalty.
Weight penalty?
Yes.
So
you have to, if you are using a cylinder, even now, today, you can use.
Yeah. But point is, whatever they are claiming that they are using hydrogen energy, that is all just not by hydride basis or anything like that. It is only
Directly they are not directly they are not using hydrogen, because you carry in an automobile a cylinder, it is equivalent to carrying a bomb in a vehicle.
So they might be carrying the hydride storage vessels.
Yes.
So it should be, I mean, is there any limit to the size of the hydride?
Yes, it is all. The whole of the automobile configuration itself has to be changed.
I see.
We also did another thing. Okay, I don't want to tell this here. We tried to generate hydrogen in situ in a car.
I see.
The same method, okay, decomposing water, but not by electrolysis, because in a car I cannot do electrolysis. Yeah. So it is a chemical reaction. We will not go into the details of the chemical reaction. We tried this and drove the car. I myself drove the car to Tirupati from Chennai. Okay, but only thing is, in a route and in a time when there will be no traffic, because it is, if it explodes, it will be very, very dangerous. Then I wanted to demonstrate this car in IIT. At that time, Ananth was the director, and he knew about this development, so he wanted me to bring the car and do it. So we brought it and put it very near to the CLT, and then started preparing it. It exploded.
It exploded?
Yes. I will tell you what is that happened. Okay. So therefore, the whole Maruti car became nothing. Okay. Anyway, we will not talk about it.
I see. But it was run for...
No, it was preparing to run.
No, I'm telling you, said you ran it.
After this explosion, we found out why it has happened and all those things. Then I drove the car from Chennai to Hyderabad.
I see.
Well, these are all done for a company which is associated with the previous chief minister of Andhra Pradesh. So we will not name him and all those things. Jagan Mohan Reddy's father.
No, but what is the present situation then?
That chemical method is possible still, but it is dangerous.
Okay. So, now, was the institute, IIT, was it in any way financially compensated?
No. This was done by the uncle of the Jagan Mohan Reddy's father.
I see. No, but they paid for all this.
Yeah, they paid for all of this. Even the car was paid by them.
But you were paid for it?
No.
I was only
helping them.
I see. Okay, and something which is very interesting. Now, you have also worked on hydride batteries. What is the difference between hydride batteries and hydrogen storage? What is the difference?
Now, hydride batteries because you know very well the combustion value of hydrogen is very high compared to any other thing.
Yeah,
so therefore, hydride batteries is better. But today, hydride batteries are not so famous. Lithium-ion batteries alone is, for example, in this year's Nobel Prize and last year's Nobel Prize should have gone to Goodenough.
Yeah.
because he was the man who invented the lithium-ion battery. Okay, but unfortunately, for some reason, we will not go into all of the reason. He published a paper in March, end of March, March 27th, on lithium-ion battery. It made a stir in the whole world. Okay, but unfortunately, what happened is that paper. It is not yet published, so I don't want to discuss that, but still we can discuss the science. There is a flaw in that paper. So that was pointed out by a scientist from MIT. Therefore, it is not out because the Nobel Prize was being considered. Therefore, this objection comes, the Goodenough's name will go. So therefore, even now it is not yet published.
Now, let me just digress for a minute from the research. Now, you have guided a large number of students. Now, with how many are you still in contact? Can you name some of them?
Nearly 90%. I have guided, I will not say. I have been associated.
Okay.
About more than 120 students.
Not only in chemistry, but in other departments also.
The whole institute and also some other institute, because you know very well that. So, not only in Chennai, okay, wherever, even up to Tejpur in one corner, in the western corner up to Gujarat.
Okay. So now, any of your students or those with whom you are associated, have received the Distinguished Alumnus Award of the Institute?
I don't remember, I don't keep track of it, but the...
Who is it that has now heading the laboratory of Goodenough?
Oh, Mandiram, okay.
Has Mandiram received it?
Yes.
Mandiram received it, okay. I think we'll check in the Distinguished Alumnus Award.
He received it.
You have worked with Palani Swamy.
Yes.
Is Palaniswamy also in some way? No, Mandiram only, he has. What about DuPont fellow, M.A. Subramaniam?
M.A. Subramaniam did not get the aluminum.
No, he didn't get it. He is a PhD from our place. Okay, now let me just, this is about the students. And you say you remember most of the students. Now you did some work for... some company in USA, Columbia
Chemicals.
Yeah, was it industry?
Okay, I will just
project?
Tell you the story of the Columbian Chemicals. I went to United States. Up to that year, I did not even step into any of the Eastern countries. I only stayed in India. Okay, I stepped into United States only after 2000, after my retirement.
No, but you had been to Germany and...
That is right. I mean, the United States.
United States, okay.
So, when I went to Columbian Chemicals, at that time one of my students was in Columbian Chemicals, Srinivas.
Yeah.
So, he invited me to, at that time meeting only the hydrogen storage address was there. So, he invited me, so I went there. I don't want to name the vice president. He said they were in the business of making carbon. Okay, the carbon is low-end carbon for tire manufacture and other things. At that time, the carbon can be made very, very value addition, carbon electrodes and other things. Okay, we will not talk about it. So, he threw me a challenge because they have invested in two best institutes in the United States and United Kingdom. Now itself, you can imagine what will be the names of the institutions, Cambridge and MIT, to make this carbon material into value addition.
Uh-huh.
Value addition means it should not be useful to the low-end use. It should be a gram of carbon must cost you $1,000, like that. So, he gave this project, he came to IIT, he gave me this project in March 1 year. Then he said, every 6 months I will visit you. You tell me the progress. So, by September he came, I gave them the process.
I see. Uh-huh.
At that time, the two other institutions, we will not worry about that, they could not even progress anything.
Now, was IIT Madras compensated for this?
No, I will tell you. Then he said, I should give you some reward for this. So he said, I will give you $20,000 free, without any commitment. Then I said, I don't take any money for any of these things. So give this $20,000 to our institute.
Yeah.
So they gave the money to $20,000 to the institute. We with the condition that it should be used for research purposes of our laboratory.
Same thing. Okay. You can call it research based.
So like that, he was even willing to give more, but at that time there was some restrictions.
I see.
This type of donations we cannot get certain amount only.
I see. Oh, it was not called a research-based industrial concept.
No. It was a gift.
Oh, because what I did was I converted.
That is a different thing.
I see. Okay. Oh, that's now that is at Colombian, because I see quite a few things mentioned in our patents that it is being it has been patented by the company.
Yes.
Oh, they have patented it.
They have made
money on that one. Now, as of now, has that two Western universities contributed?
No, but Colombian Chemicals itself has been sold to some Taiwanese and things.
Okay.
So it did not get through.
Okay, now I will go back to something else. Now you know that our department was associated, or the chemistry department to the catalyst group, was known in most of the Western countries, I don't say about USA, Europe and all that, as a center for catalysis research. Now you know that Russian group used to come and attend even our, and some others from Germany, other countries also. Now, do you remember the visit of some of the Germans who came to IIT Madras chemistry department?
Yes, I know.
During 70s, can you name? And you went to one of them to do your postdoc.
Professor Block is one of them.
Yes.
Professor Notzinger is one of them. And then Helmut is another person.
Professor?
Helmut, from the Fritz-Haber Institute, who is working on fuel.
Karge, Helmut Karge. Now, what about the person?
Anike and Ernst.
Huh?
Ernst and...
Now, wait a minute. Now, Professor Block, you went to Professor Block to spend a postdoctoral with him. I mean, I think von Humboldt Fellowship. And again, I think you worked for some time as Max Planck Fellow also. Now, you must have definitely visited their workshops. So, the excellent workshop extending over. So, you must have possibly built also, use the workshop for your research work and all that. Now, you have published with Professor Block some papers.
Yeah, no, not a lot of papers.
But you have not, I think you have mentioned only one paper or two papers.
Because, but anyway, for more than 5 or 6 papers with him.
I see. But during the time when you were with Professor Block, was the Nobel laureate?
Ernst.
Yeah. Was he also there?
Ertel.
The Nobel...
Ertel.
Was he also there?
He was not there at the time, but okay. I know him.
Okay. Now, if I were to say that if Professor Block were to be alive, when Professor Ertel got the Nobel Prize, it would have been awarded to both of them together. Would you agree that?
Not that way. Block would have got it individually. Because Block has developed, for example, I will tell you one thing. Just now we have an instrument which is costing about, we will not worry about the cost, B.S. Murthy has installed. This technique itself was developed first, we developed, okay, myself and Block and others, okay, we will not name all of them. So we were developed, but we did not succeed at that time. Photo-induced ionization.
Photo-induced ionization spectroscopy.
Yes. The same technique, only now it is commercially available, and B.S. Murthy has invested about maybe 50-60 crores.
What for is this?
It is studying the fragmentations that are taking place inside the thing with the voltage, high voltage.
Now, how is B.S. Murthy's in metallurgical.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But he is interested in the metallic clusters and things. That is not a thing, okay, because it is a laser beam, so it is instantaneous heat.
I see.
So therefore you can evaporate any metal.
But then your interest was on what?
On field ionization. Field ionization requires very, very high field, 10 to the 8 volts per angstrom. So that means I should apply 30,000 volts or 40,000 volts. 40,000 volts in a room, if you are applying, what a danger. So therefore, we wanted to bring down that application of the voltage on the metal tip. This is called tip filament. We will say take filament. So therefore, we wanted to bring down that voltage. So we wanted to do voltage plus photons, so that it will ionize easily. The concept itself is a new thing there. At that time, okay, it was in 78.
78, I see. No, what I felt was, because Atul came, Professor Atul came later, and then Atul and Somarjoy were working parallelly and they were in contact. But I felt that when Atul got it, he would have Bloch also.
Bloch was, if Bloch was were to be alive, he would have got it Nobel Prize even earlier than Atul.
I see. Now that we talked about Nobel Prize, have you visited in Fitz Harper Institute the room where the Nobel Prize in
Earth? Yeah, yeah. It will be a room slightly
almost around this size.
About the size. On the wall, there will be photographs of that.
All the Nobel laureates.
Yes, there will be 20-25. In the Fritz Haber Institute itself will be a Nobel Prize will be 2025, and many others who are very near to the Nobel Prize. For example, you take Gerischer in this years, okay, Bloch's year, there was a talk that Gerischer and Bloch both will get the Nobel Prize, but Gerischer was the director and Bloch was the previous director.
I see.
The rotating system is existing long ago. Then Atul became the director. When Bloch died, then Atul became the director.
No, you have visited, because he had taken me to that room and...
I attended many seminars in that room.
Yeah.
I myself have given a seminar there.
So, okay, going back to that, you have spent some time in Japan also. What was your work in Japan?
In Japan, I was working, development of silicon at that time, this is in 83-84, gating technique.
I see.
So reducing the time of gating technique.
I see.
So silicon based systems were doing. We were measuring.
So it is. In which this one does it come? Does it come under materials or does it come
it is
under?
It can be considered as materials. At that time only the silicon single crystals. I was using single crystal only. Single crystal and technology. Single crystal is known for centuries together, but the technology, especially in the electronics industry, silicon single chips were there. For example, you said they are same thing. It was done. The work was done for a company, and our instrument some fault was there, and I had only 8 months time, so therefore the instrument has to come from United Kingdom.
I see.
So when I phoned up the company, they said, how many hours is the flight from United Kingdom to Japan? We were in Japan, in Tokyo, in Hokkaido. Hokkaido is very much away from Tokyo. 4 or 5 hours flight for a thing, but anyway, we will not worry. Then they said 24 hours you wait, 24 hours you spend your time, 24 hours it will be deposited to you. So within 24 hours it was there on my table.
The instrument?
And that part.
I see. So, let me now come to a later part. Now you were associated with the catalysis division almost from its inception. Professor Kuriakos became the head of the catalysis division in 1984, and we got associated with the MRL project from 84 onwards, and he got the building, the kinetic catalysis lab, and the cattle division almost simultaneously around 85-86, because it was a Seljuk-Tupolev cooperation agreement. Now, you were involved initially because, you know, when Professor Whitecomb, the coordinator, came, and then you were involved in all that SWOT analysis and all that. Finally, you know that we were not very much consulted on the type of equipment, what make and what this one had to be, we wanted. They decided everything on it. Even when we, in the first agreement or the third IIT agreement, when we got equipment from Professor Shastri's time, you remember the planner on the German side, had you met him, Professor Kerber?
I didn't
technically meet him. You see, Professor Kerber, I don't think made any much visits to this place. He had visited once, and we have a photograph of his in that some organization meeting. But then he, the professor who was sent was one Professor Butenoth, who must have known him.
Butenoth, I know very well.
Yeah, but Butenoth, what was his specialization, we could not make out. He was
Mineral chemist.
Mineral chemistry, and so he could not do anything, and he did not, possibly it was a misfit in chemistry. So he spent his time, I felt, he felt very miserable during that 1 year, and he went away but wanted to keep in touch with two people who went to Germany afterward, Professor Ramana and Professor V.R.S. Rao, sorry, Professor Udupa, and he took them around and all that. Anyway, that was not a very good this. Now, let us come to the catalysis division time. You know, after Whitecomb started supplying the equipment, one of the equipment that was supplied, I felt, was a waste. That was a hydrogen plant. And you know that the room set up, and then it was all a... What happened to that one after I retired? It was all demolished. Because we could not use it because it was in a semi-industrial level, and that had to be connected by lines to the hydrogen into the main lab to be used for chromatography purposes.
Yeah, but see, this was done 30 years before, or 40 years before, in 70s, around
80s.
So, that's, hydrogen is a safety measure, okay?
Yeah.
It is a very dangerous to do such hydrogen production inside a building, inside an institution.
Yeah.
And it is put in the midst of physics, chemistry, and other things. And it was put in a very small room. So it is operationally, it was not, cannot be a successful thing.
I know. That's what I am telling you, that, you see, the supply, I mean, they decided to supply certain things which were not of use to us, which you could not put to use. Okay, same thing happened in the case of the first set of equipment and all that. Now, on behalf of the Heritage Center, I would like to ask you something. You know, you had used it, I had used it. We used to use a mechanical facet calculator. Do we have any one of them in the chemistry still?
We don't have a facet calculator, but we had number of them. Okay.
No, do you know where we can get one? Do we want to put it in the Heritage Museum? So we are asking, asking people who have used it. All the departments have used it, I remember.
I have used it extensively.
Yeah. Now, For the purpose of the Heritage Center, I want to tell that then we were the two who were doing all the donkey's work as far as the seminars in the chemistry department are concerned. Right from 1967, I think, when we arranged the solid state chemistry symposium. So we had to take care of the projectors, we had to take care of all the arrangements. And then I think it was done even when all the resonance meetings were, intercollegiate meetings were. I think we were the last to go out in the evening, taking all the projectors along with some research students and all that. I mean, I can never forget. So
not only in the city of Madras, when we organized a catalysis symposium in Dunbar.
I see. There was,
I do not know whether you remember.
No.
You traveled with us. We took the projector not right. Slide projector alone, even the overhead projector from here.
That was for the workshop.
Workshop, for catalysis
because
workshop.
I came only for the Sindri, this one.
Okay. But it is in ISM Dhanbad.
Yeah, yeah. That.
Recently, I was in Dhanbad, I was remembering that.
I see. Because I went only for the what Sindri organized.
Yeah, Sindri is different.
The guest house was all horrible in a sense, lot of mosquitoes and all that. That is where we gave the eminent scientist award for the first time.
Yeah, yeah.
So, Prof. M.C. Shastri gave an address and they received the award. Now, Prof. Viswanathan has also received the eminent scientist award at Catalyst Society in addition to several other awards which you have listed here. So, I just want to once again take you back to some of the joint projects that we might have done together. So, for example, one is this thing about MRL project. Another is about the work on X-ray photoelectron. I mean, it's installing and then doing some work on the XPS things. What is the present situation about? I think that instrument is condemned.
That instrument is condemned, but now we have a new instrument.
Is it now working?
Yes, it is working.
I see.
And we are the only institution or only center which were giving service free of charge to anybody in the whole of this country and even in the whole of the world.
What are the facilities available? I have never come visited.
For catalysis, you have everything there. In a modern all spectroscopies and all even we have a TEM, very very 2 angstroms you can resolve.
I see.
The best instrument is 1 angstrom, but our instrument can resolve 2 angstroms. Because we are going to use a catalyst and other things which is a dirty material, so 1 angstrom instrument will be spoiled very easily. That is why we went in for a 2 angstrom. This cost was around 10 crores, all put together, okay, the instrument and the room and other things.
I mean, now what?
It is working.
I see.
It is giving service for the whole of this country, even for IIT. Even though in IIT we have at least 5 microscopes, 10 microscopes.
I see.
But ours is the most extensively used instrument.
Oh, I see. Even the electron microscopy.
Electron microscopy.
Now, you know, we received one thing for gas analysis. I'm not talking about what happened to the GCMS. I don't know. That was condemned, is it?
That was condemned.
Now, we used to have another, you know, gas analysis. We couldn't use there was no software available for getting the detailed data and all that. And then Professor Karge sent us the reaction unit to be used along with the infrared spectrometer. That is also not set up, is it? I think by then the Pakkanamar IR instrument.
Yeah, but now we have, nowadays commercially there are very various instruments. At that time we had to get it custom made by Karge.
Yeah.
But now it is all available. It is possible even now in our instrument.
I see. You have facilities for all
yeah,
that?
Yeah.
It is all
now commercially available.
I see. Now I just want to ask you about, you know, Professor Blog. Since I visited his institute in 1989, it's a few months before the unification. And of course, I will not tell about this small incident which happened when he took us for a walk after lunch. But then I made a comment to him the day I was leaving, so that said it is a waste that this the East Germany and West Germany separated. And then I was sitting much later when I went with 89, I went along with Professor Pillai as a visiting. And we were sitting at the front, that gate, and then I said, what a waste I think this wall has to come down. We didn't have a camera even to take a photograph. And 4 months later, it came down. So in fact, I have been mentioning that when, since we would like to do a historical survey of IIT Madras, no history has been written, it will be a Diamond Jubilee history which they are going to write. The first 30 years ends in 89. So our collaboration was with FRG. So from 89 onwards, it is with Germany, the unified Germany. And I remember in 90, you and I were invited by Professor Knossinger and his wife. We were guests in a gala thing somewhere. I think German consulate had invited us for a party in the evening. We were both guests of Professor Knossinger. You remember that? So,
yeah.
So Professor Block, of course, had come a few months earlier. No, Professor Block, because I mentioned about this wall, he brought a piece of that wall and presented it to us. Do you have it in the... I passed it on to you or I passed it on to the head of the department? I don't remember.
No, I recently saw that.
Where is it?
I don't know now, but I can locate it.
If it is in...
Some plastic container.
It is covered with polythene. Can you please... We would like to keep it at Heritage Center with Professor Block's name, if possible, a photograph of Professor Block.
Okay. I will locate.
Please. Because I was thinking it was in the head of the department.
It was in the head of the department office only. Even now it may be in the head of the department. Because since I was also head of the...
That is what
I'm therefore saying. I remember to have seen it. Recently also I saw that. Therefore...
You check whether you have in your room. If not,
it is not in my room. But anyway, I will locate it.
Please let us know about that one. Now, is there something which you would like to say about the IIT of those days when you joined in 1964 and the IIT of today? So, campus-wise, by way of the contribution that IIT has made, because you have spent 50 years, but I can tell only up to when I retired. Now, as I can tell you, I'll give you a hint also. One professor, Professor Anand, nobody else, he said that then, since 2000, the amount of money IIT has been getting is enormous because there is absolutely no problem about funding, human organization funding. So that is why the research output has also increased. You can do newer type of research and all that. So, I mean, I myself telling you, this is one of the observations that we have made. Do you have any observations to make?
But, this is not, I don't want to
personal. Your personal thing you can tell.
Anant is a very knowledgeable person. But recently, I have been asked by a Chinese writer. Okay, recently means 2 or 3 days back. She is trying to compare the performance of, there is a feeling, okay, there is a feeling that the Indian science and technology has come down in the last 2 or 3 years, okay, from 2014 onwards.
Has come down?
Come down.
Okay.
As compared to 2014, 2013, like that.
I see.
And she asked, she is going to write it in Nature. Enlisted to write in Nature. So she asked me, she wanted to get opinion from people. She is not taking opinion only from me. Some 20 or 30 people from India. Even Balraman is one of them. But Balraman declined. I even talked to him, but he declined.
I see.
Maybe for some reason. We will not go into all the reason.
Yeah.
So, the conclusion that we came, okay, it is not yet published, so I cannot say this is the conclusion. But mostly what we are feeling here is the science and technology that is being practiced today in India. For example, the new faculty. Let us take only IIT.
Okay.
Very small segment. The research, I am not denying the research has to be done, that is not a question. But what they are doing is, what they have done in their postdoc or whatever they have done in the Western world, that is what is being practiced here.
I see.
So that is why this science was growing in this country, because we were practicing what is feasible in this country.
Not only that, new things
and feasible, because the people who are directing the research were from this soil.
Yeah.
Now the people who are directing the research is displaced people from other places.
Yeah.
So therefore, I am not denying these are all very modern things. For example, I will tell you an example. The material that we are looking for, one of the material is the oxygen reduction electrode. It is a very exotic electrode. Okay, if I know how oxygen is getting reduced, I know about the life. I can tell you how long I will live, on what day I will die.
What is that again?
Oxygen reduction, because we are only consuming oxygen.
Yeah.
And the oxygen is combusting our food.
Right.
Carbohydrate.
Right.
So therefore, oxygen has to get reduced to O2 minus. Reduced to O2 minus.
Mm-hmm.
This reduction reaction has to be understood.
Mm-hmm.
This reduction reaction has been understood by our saints. That is why they were able to predict when you will die and all those.
Right.
Now we are not able to do that.
I see.
So therefore, this is a very electrochemical reaction. That is all. Yeah, two electron transfer to an oxygen atom.
Uh-huh.
It is a 4-electron transfer, but we will not go into the details.
Mm.
So therefore, this is now available electrode is platinum, but in our body there is no platinum.
Mm.
So therefore, there is some biomolecule that is doing this.
Mm.
And we should repeat that biomolecule in a material.
Yeah.
So the material is FeN4. It is a iron phenanthrene complex.
I see.
The phenanthrene is nitrogen containing compound. So now four ligands of phenanthrene, therefore the structure of the final compound will be FeN4.
Mm.
For chemists it will be a very wonderful material, because there is no valency, nothing is satisfied here. So this FeN4 is a very important material in the United States today.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody who is working on FeN4, they will be given the grant from NSF.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
mm. But we cannot afford to use that. I even published a paper in 2002 or 2003 on FeN4.
I see. Mm-hmm.
Showing that it will be a very good oxygen reduction electrode. You will ask me immediately, even if some students were asking when they read it, why you did not continue. At that time, the facilities were there, only I can do only theoretical calculations. I could not do an experiment at that time. Even today, we cannot afford to do those research here. You can publish.
Yeah.
And get some name and all those things, that is all very different. But what is the outcome for this country?
Okay, now again I'll I told you that we had Russian visitors and all that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were one of those who got at least the catalysis laboratory. You know, one of the Russians came and spent more than a month or two. Remember the name of that person?
Ermakov.
Not Ermakov.
Mm.
There was a junior scientist who came and worked in our lab for 1 month.
I don't remember.
1979, you were very much there.
Yeah.
I am not able to get his name.
Mm.
And I introduced him to nitrous oxide. I told him, see, he was interested in catalytic reaction and all that. I said, okay, we had purchased all that the various parts required for building a chromatograph. So I told him, you can set up a chromatograph and you can show the student. Then I told him, see, 3 or 4 students work on nitrous oxide decomposition. You just get used to that. And he worked with them. He was very friendly with all the students. He even went with them to part of South India and all that. I am not able to get his name, but I will tell you, he was the person who later patented the oxidation of benzene to phenol using nitrous oxide. Now you remember the name?
But I know this reaction, benzene.
The nitrous oxide, he was introduced to nitrous oxide by us in our laboratory, because I told him, he asked me, why are you interested? I said, one reason we are interested is a very simple reaction. So we can do a large number of compounds we can investigate, and it tells us about the redox behavior and so many other things. Anyway, that was different. You were doing carbon monoxide oxidation. These were the two things we were developing. But just remember the type of catalyst we tried, or the type of oxides we tried, they later received importance in materials chemistry. For example, the K2NFO structures. And remember, we were working on the manganites. Do you remember what we lost in the manganites finally? That was this Nobel Prize, which was given in 1980s and 90s, manganites. Yeah. What was those? Again, I forget.
That is a perovskite structure.
Perovskite structure. You see, they substituted. Yes. Same thing K2NFO. I was doing the B-side substitution, whereas A-side substitution which was done, and they got the CO3+. CO3+, I had also observed it, but I had no way of checking it, because we didn't have except for a transportometer. Remember, we tried to do that for the first thing with the student Madhavan.
Yes.
So, who is no more?
We XPS.
Yeah, XPS of that.
Actually, even now, that is a fertile field. We looked at the satellite peaks, not the main peaks.
Yeah. Satellite position. That's what I said. You see, do you at any time, not that one should get a Nobel Prize or anything like that. One of the things which is being pointed out again and again is, India says it has done this thing, that thing. It has not produced Nobel Prize. And do you believe, at least because you have worked on various things, that then we might have reached a stage where it was going to fetch a Nobel Prize, but we didn't pursue it.
Okay. In the next few years, we will be,
at least even earlier, we had worked on areas.
Yeah, but
later we left it.
Nobel Prize is a very different question, sir. We will not discuss that.
No, not like that. For not sight of Nobel, that we got it or not. Because at that level of research, we have been doing it.
Yes.
That is exactly
definitely,
what I am
definitely.
Asking. That's exactly what I am. Just like you said that somebody in US said that 67% of storage, and you proved that it is nonsense. Same way when somebody said a nickel compound was showing superconductivity, just like the copper compound, and then only two people in the whole world has reported it. And then I asked one of the co-workers of one of the students, one of the professors who reported, do you agree with that one? He said, whether I agree or not, my professor and another professor, they claim they have observed it, superconductivity. I don't want a name. It was a nickel compound corresponding, not the copper compound, nickel compound. And one of the scientists, of course, an Indian, another was an American scientist. So, what I am telling is that such things do happen. And I know of times when you were very depressed, say when you were about to publish something or about and somebody else has done something, or you are not able to do something because of lack of facilities and all that. And I think over time, you must have got over all those feelings. So, what is your program for the next 2 or 3 years?
Okay, next 2 or 3 years, because you may be knowing that at the moment, my worry is about the Indian science. That's all. Okay. That is why we are conducting a course called the Orientation Program. Orientation Program is meant for research scholars. Even the DST has many times ridiculed me. What you can teach to a PhD student? Teach. Okay, PhD students will...
The current course you are conducting now?
Oh yeah, it is the 18th year. continuously 18 years I have conducted.
Which department?
It is the catalysis division, catalysis center.
Oh, I see. Oh, I see. This catalysis. No, that is not. You are now a guest faculty of chemical engineering. I thought you are only
catalysis center. It was done on behalf of the chemistry department from 1999 onwards.
I see.
This is the 18th year. We will, at that time I used, because the fund is required, because the research scholars have to be brought from various places. Some 30-40 research scholars will be brought here, kept here for 3 weeks or 4 weeks, and they will be given an orientation to research in catalysis.
I see.
And we have trained about 600 to 700 people in this 17 courses, out of which 300 people are top class research scholars in the world today. And they are all in communication with me day to day, not a stray communication.
I mean,
they come on online and discuss with me. We are doing this research. Whether it is, can you give me some suggestion about that and all that?
This is spread internationally.
Yes, and that is one thing. It is not international because of DST funding. Because we cannot sponsor the candidates from abroad.
No, not the candidates. The students who are trained abroad now.
The students have gone abroad because they get PhD and all that. Even foreign students have attended this course. When they applied for this course, I used to tell them, we will take care of your local expenses.
But we cannot
give you the travel allowance. You manage. So they spent from their packet and attended this course. Is from Germany, from USA, from Australia.
I see. Is it publicized in any of these?
I do not know. But it is, even now, the next course is 18th course, is starting on November 27th.
I see.
DST has very well recognized this now. As a matter of fact, wherever DST exhibits something, they will talk about this course only. First, the first projection will be on this course only.
I see. I didn't know that. I see. Anyway, I'm not.
Anyway, leave alone. So therefore, this is one thing. Second thing is, we have now launched at least about this year itself. That is 2017. We are in the fourth online course.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing is required. All that you require is a computer. That is all.
I see. Online. Mm-hmm.
This is for educating people. Mm. This is the second thing we are doing. Third thing that we are doing is, since I have some facilities to write, I write many books. Even now there is a book, if I tell you, you will be surprised. The title itself, Carbon Dioxide to Chemicals and Fuels.
Right.
Because carbon dioxide is a waste, that is what people think. Mm-hmm. But if I were to take the carbon dioxide and convert it to chemicals and fuels, I am closing the cycle.
Mm.
But it is going to be a technology 30 years from now or 20 years from now. But I have written a book now on that.
Mm.
And one of the leading publishers of the world, looking at the title, they approved it. Nothing else. No, they did not even ask me to give you usually they ask 2 or 3 chapters.
Yeah.
The top man told, no, we don't want any chapter from you. We are agreeing to publish it. So you complete the book and send it to us.
I see. Okay. Now, I know that right from the inception up to now, you are connected with the Catalyst Society of India. In various capacities, and it's continuing. Now, what will be the future? Of course, you are leaving it in good hands and going. You must have conducted a lot of QIP programs and FIP programs and all that. So, as you say, you are now doing this orientation program, which is now you also were involved sometime about the library science, in the sense before all this, the present thing of talking about the classical, citation index And what is the number?
Impact factor.
You know, all that we want before that, that American who was bringing out that current contents, what is his name? The person who started all this, along with Arunachalam, I forget the name of that. He visited IIT also.
Yeah.
And you had arranged a lecture.
He just now passed away.
I see.
One year back.
Great man. Starting with G or something like that.
Yeah.
I'm forgetting the name. And you had written some ways of classification and all that. You had written some books also. I mean, articles on that. Now, what is your that number?
Impact factor.
What is your impact factor? Not impact factor, that number. The number of times the paper is quoted.
For the journal, it is impact factor. For the individuals, it is citation index.
No.
Now it is also there. Google is doing that.
No. Not. I am not talking of this impact factor, the citation index. But then from that, you derive another thing.
There are many other terms. Immediacy index is one of them. How immediate is your research is there? So in the, for example, if I publish a paper today, the next 2 years, whether it is seen or not.
I see. That also is.
Yeah. This is called immediate index. There are many indices.
No, but you, other day I was asking you, you told me something, you were number.
There are many.
No, more than 70. What is that one? What is the number? Number of papers have been quoted so many times.
Yeah.
What is that number, Nolan? What is it? You are talking of impact. I am not talking of the impact factor.
Impact factor is for the journals.
Journal. So it is not citation index. Based on the citation index, you evaluate a number. That is, yours was coming to 70 or something like that. You were telling scholastic.
I don't remember now.
We got Prasena Rao's 300.
Yeah. I remember
that. What is that number known? How is it yours or get the number? There is a number which everybody quotes because for Bhatnagar Award, you should have at least 25.
Yeah.
So I remember that one. That is why I am asking you. And if you are a fellow of more than two Indian academies, I think the government will give some 15,000 rupees or so. I think possibly LDST give. I don't remember. So that is something many people would like to trying to get. Mr. Kumaran, I wanted to ask some questions.
Yes, sir. Sir, can I ask you about what IIT's reputation was in 64 when you joined it? As an MSc graduate, what was your perception of IIT at that point? Because in that student circle, was it well known as an excellent institute?
No.
And how did you apply and what happened? Yes. I just want to know about that, sir.
I applied because I knew one of the professors in Madras University at that time. He recommended me to join IIT. Because he came and taught me in MSc in St. Joseph's, so B.S. Thayarajan, he only introduced me to IIT. So when I came, I have seen all the convocations in this institute.
Yes.
From 64 onwards.
Oh my God, very good.
Okay. So anyway, that is a different thing.
Yes.
So at that time, IIT, especially IIT Madras, okay, I will talk about IIT Madras because IIT Madras is one of the top IITs. There is no doubt about that, okay. So, at that time, IIT Madras was not very well known.
Okay.
So, therefore, those of us who were the first few batches, we have to make an advertisement for IIT Madras. Mm. I have made that attempt also.
Uh-huh.
For example, in the rural areas, at that time, the AE was not even known.
Yes.
The village from which I am coming, it is a very, very knowledgeable village, but they did not know the JE. In the first batch or second batch, the MSc, the BTech students, at least five or six of them are because I told them to write the JE.
Okay.
That is how the IIT glory comes. I am not claiming that I did the whole thing, okay. That is how the IIT glory of IIT Madras glory came up. Because at that time we were coming from villages, and villagers were not even knowing that there is an IIT. And even if they know IIT, they did not know how to apply for JEE and write the JEE. Because JEE system, even today, because even now I am some way connected with the JEE. Okay, JEE is not with IIT now, the main paper, it is with the government, secondary education board. But anyway, we will not talk about all those things. So therefore, JEE is a different cup of tea for all the Indians. That must be very, very clearly known to us. So therefore, the people from the villages, they did not know about JEE at that time. Now it is known. That is because now it is 50 years.
Yes.
So at that time, the JEE was not even known. In spite of the fact, my village is one of the well exposed to other areas.
And you chose to join a relatively new institution in favor of a larger organization.
When I joined,
yes,
there was no room. Only cement bags were there.
I see.
I do not know whether you remember. I sat in a room where in a one side of the room only cement bags will be there.
I see.
With the cement.
This was BSB, sir?
No, HSB.
No, he, by the time he joined, we had moved to HSB.
HSB, right.
He had moved to HSB.
Right.
No, the things were getting added. There was no German equipment or anything. One by one, we started getting by other fundings. But our laboratory was better equipped than most of the laboratories. And I hope he will not mistake me if I raise one of his hands for your sake. See this finger. His interest in the laboratory. One day he started a motor and then the motor was not starting and he didn't see that the switch is on and he started rotating. His finger got cut. And then it was collected, it was thrown, it was collected, put in liquid nitrogen. It was rushed to the railway hospital. But unfortunately, by that time, I think it has started deteriorating. So they could not. I mean, I can always remember, you know, a part of that finger goes. It happened in the HSP laboratory. So
what
thank
was,
you.
Can I just add a few more questions, sir?
Please.
What was the procedure for selection to a PhD? You joined the PhD program when you came to IIT first. And who were the staff members the faculty members who interviewed you? At that time,
the three solvers in the chemistry, or four solvers, M.V.C. Sastri, J.C. Kuriakose, V. Srinivasan, and C.N. Pillai, Aravamudam. These are the five people who grilled us. Really grilled us, and also we have this examination at that time, also the same type of examination, and the examination is used to be very, very tough. Actually, even now I remember Kuriakose to
did you have YOC?
Not YOC, written examination only.
Oh, you had a written examination.
Five papers we have to write. So
no, for joining the thing you need not have to.
Joining was interview only.
Yeah.
Not written exam.
Yeah.
Right.
But after joining the qualification, for example, Kuriakose paper, none of us passed. Only I passed. The three of us were there in that batch. Only I passed. That too because I took a challenge with him.
About your wardenship, you said you had a term as warden. How many years and which hostels were you?
Okay, I spent first as assistant warden, Kaveri, Krishna, then as warden in Ganga Hostel, then as chairman council of wardens. So therefore, nearly 30 years I was associated with the hostels.
You were also kind of the Gymkhana.
Yeah, Gymkhana, cultural advisor, weaker section advisor, many roles.
No, you were, I think in the sports day, this one, his photograph has been put in the, in our, the portico.
Because I was dean students also.
Dean students, I think. So,
I have occupied all positions in this institute.
Is that person there? So.
Yes.
Yeah. Is there anything you want to ask him? And maybe some of your some of the books that you have written, and if you have a spare copy, at least general books, not exactly on subject things, that we would very much like to have it in the Heritage Center, and we don't mind buying it also. He's prepared to buy it, but then if you can give it as a one, because we are collecting. You are an alumnus, so as an alumni, we would like to collect all those books. Spoken to you, and then elicited lot of information. And I think if there was another chance, I would have spent a few more hours with you talking about this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.